Hey, fools. T here with your Nintendo news, so let's get into it. Yeah. All right, guys, you all probably already know about the wonderful Nintendo Switch sales by now. Nintendo Switch is at 14.8 million. Definitely over that by now. I think these numbers go to the end of December. Xenoblade Chronicles is over a million sold. Super Mario Odyssey is over 9 million sold. That is bananas. That is a ridiculous attach rate. 9 million. That is just crazy. I can't remember attach rates that high. And Zelda also at 7 million roughly. I think, you know, they didn't count the Wii U version, which we all know sold over a million. So I guess it's around 7, late 7, 8 million or so. Mario Kart 8 Deluxe, close to, I believe, 8 million. I'm not going to go into the detailed and have the exact numbers here because that's just not something that compels me that much. There are a lot of other channels that I watch that are better at this stuff, news channels, so go check that out if you want that. You can go to Nintendo's website as well. I think I'll have a graphic up so you can see the exact numbers on the hardware and stuff like that. But this is all great stuff, obviously. Switch is a roaring success. You know, it's broken, you know, all kinds of records and whatnot throughout its short lifespan so far. And it's continuing to do great, which is amazing. There's a narrative about how, you know, it smashed Wii U sales, you know, in less than a year, which is obviously true. But I I contend that that isn't, you know, that compelling of a thing because we all know that Wii U sold pretty poorly. The Switch is a success in its own right. You don't really need to compare how well it did over the Wii U in a year to show how great it's doing. This isn't just, you know, something to compare to Wii U. You compare this bad boy to Wii. That is a better comparison. That's, you know, you're talking about astronomical success and sales numbers. Because, you know, now that it's past the Wii U, are we going to end that narrative? Or is it now we're going to go after the GameCube? And how fast it outsells the GameCube. Again, the GameCube is another console that didn't sell well. But that said, I'm just going to stick to news for now and I'll go into a little rant at the end of the video. So along with the sales figures of the Switch and software sales, Nintendo also went into other news nuggets about the Switch and other things they're working on. One being a mobile Mario Kart that's going to release by fiscal year March 2019. That's pretty interesting. Mario Kart seems like a very smart move as far as the mobile market goes for Nintendo. Obviously, Mario Kart is a huge seller on all Nintendo consoles. It continues to be, so it makes a lot of sense that they would make a mobile version of Mario Kart. Also, they let out of the bag that they are doing an animated Mario film. It's a confirmed thing that Mario will get an animated film by the people that brought you Despicable Me and the Minions and stuff like that. So that is pretty cool. Nintendo continuing to expand their horizons and do more things beyond just gaming, which is something they used to do way back in the day, and it's cool to see them go back to that again. And I guess one of the biggest nuggets is that Nintendo will be rolling out their full online service in September of 2018, this year. So it seems that the rumor or whatever about the service coming out late this year seems to be true. I don't think it was a rumor. I think it was some kind of printing or something on their website. I didn't really pay that much attention to it because I don't really care because I tend to like free internet online multiplayer capabilities and things like that. Yes, voice chat is a big thing that a lot of gamers want. Again, I don't care about voice chat for myself, but I understand people wanting that, especially if you're going to be paying for online service, which we will be in September. They should have some more fleshed out features, some, you know, not quite exactly what Microsoft and Sony are doing, because they're offering a service for $40 cheaper than those guys, but something that gives it a little, you know, weight. And they again talked about the Classic Games kind of subscription service. So that's going to be a thing that's coming. So a lot of people wanting Virtual Console. I'm not sure that's going to happen. I thought Nintendo at some point said they were not going to do the traditional Virtual Console thing before Switch launched. People still keep talking about Virtual Console, but only thing Nintendo's really talked about is this subscription service, basically, you know, that a lot of other companies have already. So I don't know if we'll get a traditional like full-on Virtual Console. So we'll see what happens with that. So that was pretty much all the news coming out of it, and I just want to get into my little quote-unquote rant. Not really rant, just me going off the cuff and not really talking about news stuff, but being more opinionated here. First off, I want to say Nintendo fans have every right to be, you know, taking victory laps and be congratulatory and belligerent, because they faced that, I should say we've faced that, throughout the Wii U's life cycle, and to some extent even the Wii. So it's not just about the Wii U not selling. You know, guys also got on the Wii as well, even though it did sell, based on the fact that it wasn't as powerful a console, and it had, you know, they had, you know, quote unquote shovelware. Just wanted to talk about that, and the fact that, you know, there was a lot of naysayers and haters that are eating crow right now, and you don't have to be humble, Nintendo fans. Have fun, you know, make fun of the guys. It's all in good fun. Do that. Just be sensible. Like I said earlier, I wanted to talk about, you know, something that relates to the sales of Switch and whatnot, and it's the fact that the Switch does owe, you know, some of its success to Wii games. Obviously, Mario Kart 8 Deluxe being a big game that sold really well for the Switch, and it definitely helped move consoles early on. And you know, I'm glad that it wasn't just a straight port. Obviously, it got all the DLC, which is stuff that I already had, but it also, you know, got a couple new characters. You got the new mechanic of being able to switch. Well, you know, it's not new to Mario Kart, but it was at least new to Mario Kart 8, being able to switch weapons or items. And also, the biggest thing, the reason I bought it, because I don't believe I would have bought Mario Kart 8 Deluxe had it not been for a true traditional battle mode, which I love the battle mode in the game. It's mostly what I've done, you know, it's mostly what I've done is played the battle mode. And I really enjoy it. It's one of my favorite battle modes in all of Mario Kart. So that is cool, you know. And like I said, I was talking about narratives earlier. You know, the narrative of comparing Switch to Wii U. I mean, it is a big thing. I'm not saying it's not a big thing that it's already outsold the Wii U. But again, the Wii U was a failure. So it's kind of like apples and oranges. To some degree, I feel like there's a lot of after the fact, you know, Johnny come lately, Wii U dissing, you know, when it became safe. And, you know, the Wii U was so not valuable, such a non-valuable console. Then why do you want all of its games on the Switch? Well, why you want everything to be ported to the Switch that was on the Wii U? And it's one thing for somebody who hasn't played these games, who don't own these games, to want them, but it's quite another for people who already owned these games, or already currently own these games, and want, you know, to rebuy them at $60 on the Switch all over again. I'm not feeling that. Again, I found value in Mario Kart 8 because of the battle mode. I don't find that same value in Donkey Kong Country Tropical Freeze, just because of Funky Kong, which is a mode I'm not going to use. Being able to play it portably is not reason enough for me to be paying $10 more for the game brand new than I paid for it on Wii U 4 years ago. And it just bothers me, because Donkey Kong Country Tropical Freeze was my 2014 game of the year. It beat out games like Bayonetta 2 for me. And I love that game to death. And it just, I want it to do better. It's going to sell better. It's going to sell to an audience it never sold to, which is a great thing, obviously. But I just wish, because Nintendo can afford to not have it at full price. I mean, it's $20 select game on Wii U. And to put it out $10 more 4 years later is just a no-no for me. I was angry about the fact, I made videos about the fact that LEGO City Undercover was doing that same thing, coming out at $60 on the Switch and other consoles when it launched $50 on Wii U, you know, in 2013. And I didn't buy that game until it was under $40. And I talked about how it was kind of a ripoff. And I feel the same way about Donkey Kong Country Tropical Freeze. It is not going to get a pass from me because it's a Nintendo game. And, you know, that's just how I feel about it. You can disagree, fine. But I'm not feeling that. I think that's not for the fans' move, you know, for that game. For the fans' move would be to put that game out for $40 and have it reach even a wider audience, because it would be that would be an impulse buy for me. I'd buy it again at $40 because, you know, I can end up getting it for $30 with my discounts. So it would be an impulse buy for me, and then it would be an easy, you know, perfectly easy buy for anybody else at $40 who hasn't played the game before. So I think you would sell even more. But they're going for the maximum, you know, the maximum profit per game instead of what I think would be a better profit, because you get the maximum sell through. But it is what it is. People will disagree. That's fine. But, you know, a game that I covet, I just wish they wouldn't do that with that. And like I said, I did it for LEGO City Undercover, a third-party game, and I'm going to do the same thing for a first-party game. And that bothers me even more because I'm a fan. And you'll say, well, what about Doom and Skyrim? Well, I'm not, you know, obviously I'm a fan of Skyrim. I'm a fan of Doom games, obviously. But I'm not as invested in those because I know they've reached a large audience previously before the Switch, where, you know, something like Donkey Kong and even LEGO City hadn't reached a large audience. It was only on Wii U. And, you know, where I didn't care that Doom was $60. Doom was a game I never bought, so it didn't bother me as much there because of that. But also with, like, Skyrim, which is a game I did buy. I actually bought it twice. they weren't full prices or anything. I bought one version for like $25 brand new and one for probably $35 or something. So I bought both of those and they weren't even $60. But again, with Skyrim reached a huge audience. And, you know, even though it was a game I revered and liked, it didn't matter to me that it sold astronomically or sold really well on Switch. I liked it. I don't know what it's at now, but I was hoping it would sell around 500,000 copies or something at least. And, you know, it was a nice novelty to have that game on the go because of the grindy kind of RPG nature of it. So that's where that's where the gray area is. That's where the nuance is. And that's where I didn't get, you know, up in arms about it, because I didn't care as much as for it to sell, you know, where I do care for Donkey Kong Country to sell well. And I did care for LEGO City to sell well, because those are games that I revered, I liked a whole lot. So that's where my gray area, that's where my nuance is in the argument. I also wanted to quickly say, isn't it funny that, you know, there was no direct, no major direct or anything, and Nintendo released all this information. You know, so obviously some of it's just sales numbers stuff, but they released some, you know, pretty detailed things, some pretty big things, like the online, how that's going to be rolled out. They released the Mario Kart mobile thing, the Nintendo, or the Mario animated movie and stuff like that. You know, they released a lot of this stuff, and they can just do that. So, just like with E3, where everybody gets all geeked up and waits for E3 and waits for these big important reveals, people are starting to do that with, like, Nintendo Directs, and they look at them as mini E3s, and that isn't anything new. They've always looked at Nintendo Directs as mini E3s, but I think the fervor is crazier now because of the success of the Switch. But you can't do that either. It's like, Nintendo can just release information whenever they want to. And they have Twitters, they have Facebooks, they have a YouTube channel. Everything big doesn't have to be released in a Direct. Would that make a Direct more meaty? Sure. It would make it more memorable? Of course. But they don't need the Direct to be meaty and memorable. I don't know why the fans do. I just want cool game announcements in a timely fashion, so I know what I got to look forward to throughout the year. So, yeah, that's it for my little opinionated thing at the end. I hope you enjoyed the video. Went over a lot of stuff here, so let me know what you think in the comments below. As always, thank you for watching and listening, and I'll see you fools next time. Peace out.